Thank you, Pranay. That was very exhaustive and pretty much you had covered everything, but you made it sound very easy as if someone has to just read and someone has to just write some 200 words a day, but it is a lot more difficult. Probably your background is that of research and you have been doing so much of writing already before doing the newsletter. So think of it like this. I know that writing is very difficult. It takes a while. And developing an audience also takes a while. And since you also had access to an audience for some time before writing the newsletter, but yours is a very niche audience. Perhaps a lot of them will not even mind paying a bit just to access the kind of content you guys do. So I would want to know when you started the newsletter, or maybe even in the past, if you have tried to do something similar, how did you think about your audience? Because your audience comes from across the board. Like I have done a course at Takshila, and they were engineers, they were students, they were medical professionals, they were policy guys, they were PhDs who were joining. So how did you decide about this audience, like anticipating the unintended? Who should I focus at? Who should I target? Who was your target audience when you started thinking?
Right. So my intended audience, as I told you, the main aim was to educate about public policies, right? To let people know that what is happening around in public policies. So my intended audience when I began with was anyone who's not in the public policy domain already. So someone who's just has a marginal interest about reading about government and what happens. So that was the aim. So it's not meant for an expert audience. In fact, it is not meant for a niche audience as well. It is meant for just people who are interested in what happens in the government. That's all. Those who even have a cursory interest towards it. So that's why a lot of frameworks and all which we share are basics, right? We are not dealing with really complex ideas in the newsletter, in the frameworks. We don't want to complicate things. It's not meant for an expert audience as well. So that was what I began with, and we've stayed along that path over the last 7-8 months. So a lot of our audience is people who are, just wanting to know about public policies, people across age groups who want to know about it. Largely people in India, because a lot of our storytelling is about India. So that's how we went about thinking. But we've seen an additional, bonus coming in, that there are people who are also experts in that area also being subscribers. But that is not what we intended at, and that's not what we aim to do also when we're telling stories on our newsletter.
So I am a subscriber of your newsletter, and before I subscribed to your newsletter, I got attracted towards Takshila because of the demonetization, because I did not know how it happened, why it happened, and I wanted answers. I had lots of questions, and I thought understanding a bit about policy would solve that question, solve those answers, I mean, give me those answers. But so I know that a lot of people like me, but when I reached Takshila, there were people who had already decided they wanted to get into the field of policy in the future and so on and so forth. What I want, and when you decide about the audience, one way of knowing about the audience is not exactly knowing. So today you have 2,000 subscribers, but did you try to speak with a couple of people personally over a phone call or over a cup of coffee? Hey, I'm wanting to write. Do you want to read something like this? Because you have access to. That's one of the ways to know about the audience in the best possible way. Mm-hmm. I mean, agencies do that. A lot of researchers do that. We call it field research. Have you tried doing that, or have you done that, or do you plan to do that?
No, what I did is write the first edition and send it to a bunch of people and then get feedback. So that was my idea, and I had already done writing before, so I thought I'll include some parts of it, create a structure, and I just sent it to around 30-40 people whom I know, and I sought feedback from that and then tried to improve on that, right? That was my mode. Not to think about it a lot. First, get started. That's the most difficult part. So once I got started, then I thought I'll keep improving on the work. That's how I...
All right. Any specific example of a audience member or a community member whom you did not expect, but they are there, or they've written to you, or you just say someone who is a musician or someone who is a sportsman and they are kind of enjoying your newsletter? I know like a lot of academics would be there and wanting to write and wanting to know about these things more.
I don't have an idea about that. I don't think any sports person is there, though I would love to have Sachin Tendulkar subscribe to my newsletter. But
I think it will be Rahul Dravid more than Sachin. Maybe Anil Kumble. We have Arvind who wants to ask a question. Arvind, I will try to unmute Arvind and see. Arvind, please go ahead.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hi, Pranay. Thanks. This was nice. I wanted to bounce off an idea. I'm a portfolio manager and I work at Quantum Advisors. So I write a lot on India macro and India investing. And I have two sets of audiences. One is the foreign institutional investor. So that those are some of our clients and we have potential clients and I write them and I write a monthly newsletter. And then we have Quantum Mutual Fund in India, which is retail investors. And so the language, the context should be the same, but the language is very different. I have been thinking about writing something on India. So creating something like India Insights. But the thing is where I'm confused right now on starting that thing on Substack or something or any other platform is that part of it would be common. I don't have different views, right? My views are same. I have a particular view on demonetization. I have a particular view on GST and I have a particular view on COVID and fiscal. And I will be writing very similar pieces. So one will go as an official email from Quantum as an official piece or newsletter. And I also wanted to start something which is on my name, but I'll use Quantum references. Does that make sense? And I don't want to be paid ever. This is going to be because children, I'm working. So the India Insights also is an effort from Quantum, from Arvind, to get more people to know about Quantum, know about our views. So it's kind of half marketing, but also just to get your views out. Because when you do your own newsletter with your own email, it goes only to the dedicated potential clients that you have. But here with a subject, if it's good enough, it might just be more popular and also get people to engage. So this is where I'm stuck, whether should I do it or not.
So Arvind, we will cover, since we're right now talking about audience, but this part of it we will surely cover towards the end, towards the next few questions. It will probably give your answers. If not, then please come back and obviously we'll discuss more about this.
Okay.
Just give us a couple of, because let's understand how to first address the audience, because that is the most key thing, the most important thing to start with the newsletter. With writing, obviously, there are various strategies and various ways to look at it. I'll come back to you, maybe give us another 15 minutes. Just stay there. Yeah, Pranay. Pranay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah. So so obviously he has an idea and he wants to know more how to go about crafting the newsletter. So this is what you should also kind of, when you, the first idea which came to you and you have an audience in mind now that, okay, this is the kind of audience I want to write. It can be anyone who has a cursory interest in reading about public policy. Then how did you start thinking of what should be the larger, like you said, you chose a theme and then you started coming up with a format with Raghu. There is another question, who is Raghu? How should people find Raghu on Twitter or elsewhere? So that is another thing which I think we should do. So please share about Raghu for a second. Who is Raghu? And then tell us, how did the initial idea come to the fruition? How did you think about the format and the kind of topics or the content pieces you wanted to do it?
Yeah. So Raghu is Raghu. Like I don't know who is That's enough. It's just like Pranay is Pranay.
Okay. So people can't find Raghu online or talk with him. It's just okay.
Generally not online. So you won't find him on any social media.
He's the policy steer, policy sage sitting in the jungle somewhere and thinking of ideas. All right.
Okay. So the next part, yeah, content wise, right? So when I started, as I told you, my idea was to pick a discipline and not a domain that I'm going to deep dive on. So the way I thought about it is, let me just share things which will make my audience, reflect on any public policy that is happening and make them think that, you know, was this the right way to go about things or not? You know, so that was the reflection that I wanted to spark in the audience. And that's what my aim was. That's why, so then I went about thinking, okay, given that I have to make people reflect on any public policy, what content should I have in? So that's when one content that I thought was, I'll share frameworks, right? So when there are frameworks in public policy which tell when change happens in any policy. There are frameworks which tell you when a public policy actually gets picked up for implementation. There are frameworks which tell you why our capacity is low, state capacity, and that's why implementation policies are always good, but implementation is always bad, right? Why is that a common thing to say? So given that I had read some of these things, I thought I'll share those frameworks. Stakeholder management, another important thing in public policy. There are a lot of frameworks on that. So I thought if I try to educate people, maybe it will help them reflect on when they are thinking about public policy. That was one way. The second one that I told you was a lot of policies which are, happen, and then a lot of times we give excuse, right, that, the idea was great, but just the execution went wrong. I wanted to break that myth because a good policy should also have implementation in mind. And that's why I thought we'll have this section called Policy WTFs and talk about things that happen on a daily basis and the repercussions that might happen. Even without that policy happening, you can foresee some of them. An example I can give is there was this in the National Green Tribunal banned RO water purifiers above a particular TDS range. I don't know, it just happened a couple of weeks ago. So I mean, that's quite egregious that you're banning water purifiers. And so we wanted to look at what are the consequences of it. How are you going to administer this even if you ban it? What will be the consequences when you ban something? How there will be a black market which might develop and so on and so forth, right? So those are the kinds which we wanted, stories which we wanted to tell. And that's why we have a section on that. The third one is we read a lot on foreign policy as well. And it is another subset of public policy, but that's something which we read on often. And always there are many interesting things happening in the public, in the foreign policy realm. So we pick one story a week on that particular section. And then the fourth section, which Raghu writes, is he's a movie buff. So he writes on how movies tell you something about public policies. You know, so that's how it's just a combination of our interests, which flows into public policy, and we come at it from different angles.
So I'm looking at it from the point of view, like I'm creating a newsletter. So I know about my audience now somewhat from what I infer from what you've said. I know about my audience. I also know about the broad things and also some bit of depth in which I have some depth and understanding, which I want to share. Now I have these two ideas. Okay, Raghu can write about movies and policies. You can write about the foreign policies. And then about different formats and frameworks and to evaluate if something has gone wrong. Now, I have these two things in mind now, and I want to craft the first newsletter, and I want to send it to 30, 40 odd people who I already know. How did you decide, it will have three longish articles, one 150 word article, or it will have a image and an interesting one-liner right next to it so that people can have some it can have some humor. So if you can recollect like the first one which you remember, how did you go about setting it, a typesetting as they used to say in the past? How did you put it on the paper and before sending it?
So one thing that I thought was it shouldn't be long at all. So initially when I began with each story, each section which I talked about, the thing I had in mind was it shouldn't be more than 200 to 300 words, because the longer it is, the more difficult it is for people to read. So that's how I thought of it. Just give an image on frameworks. Generally, I share an image and just tell the story of what that framework can help you think about public policies. So that is how I thought about it. And I always started with the policy WTFs, because that is the humor part. There are a lot of things which happen, which go wrong, and then we have lessons to learn from that. So I thought, keep humor on top and write really short articles. So 200 words each, you can buy in 5 sections. If you have 1,200 words, that should be good enough.
Did you have a reference? Did you really appreciate some other newsletter before you thought of writing a newsletter? Like when I started writing a newsletter, I had a couple of very good references, like Benedict Evans' newsletter used to be like very short and at times a crisp summary about it. Then at the same time, someone from Scroll called Rohan started writing newsletter, The Political Fix. It had like first it appeared like articles on the news on the website itself, then obviously it became the newsletter. So I had these references. Do you have, like, did you start with a reference or the two which you really liked in the beginning?
Actually, I have been subscribed to all these newsletters that you mentioned from a long time back. And Brain Pickings by...
Yes.
Also really good. But for this newsletter, I didn't have any sort of reference in mind, because I was doing something which I hadn't seen elsewhere. So I didn't have a specific model in mind when I started. You know, I thought, let me just try with this. But I'm sure because I would have read those, some of those ideas would have percolated in this as well. Like, for example, the thing that I took away from Bill Bishop's newsletter is if you have a lot of blog quotes and you can have really short summaries about one particular news item, that is also a great way to tell, right? That's like the old blogging style, right? You have just a blog quote and 200 words about what you felt. So those were some things that we still have in our newsletter as well. But for the newsletter as such, I didn't have a specific model in mind.
All right. So now so it's like a ladder. We are like kind of climbing, like we have started with the audience and the next is a broader content strategy, which is like you just mentioned, these are the 4 or 5 building blocks which you have. And then how did you decide about Substack? Because I'm sure you guys were not using Substack before. In the like Takshila sends out Dispatch. I'm assuming it uses MailChimp to send Dispatch. And probably you were familiar with that software. But since you were mentioning that it kind of bothers you when you use MailChimp, then how did you look for the new platforms which you wanted to subscribe to? Because a very something very similar platform has come into the market. It's called ScrollStack, which is from the same publishing house, which is Scroll. And they're also giving you the same set of tools, so probably more customized towards Indian audience. How did you go about looking for it? Did you have a reference or did someone guide you? Or what was your learning from that?
Yeah.
Which you could share.
Sure. My colleagues also write 2 newsletters on China and they use MailChimp. Another colleague uses MailerLite for her writing. So as you said, we were using MailChimp as well. So there were a bunch of these platforms already existing. But the thing was, when I started using MailChimp, the formatting and etc. it was really painful for me. And it is really good if you're writing an organizational newsletter, because you will be having 30 articles. So you want to put a lot of images and you want to put articles, you want to, format them differently, indent them differently and all that, right? So for that, I think MailChimp is really powerful, but that was not what my aim was. My aim was just to write stories which are text heavy, right? And have an image or a podcast link write up. So the main factor in my mind was that it should be most uncomplicated to start off with. I shouldn't be thinking about the platform at all to begin with. So that's why I started searching, and a couple of people I knew were already on Substack. So I just thought, does it work for them? Before that, I was on Medium as well. So I did a lot of writing on Medium and blogs as well. But then Medium sort of became a gated thing, right? And you were not able to anyways reach out to a larger number of people. So I was searching for something else, and that's when saw a bunch of people writing on Substack, and the setup and all was so easy to get started off with. So I thought, let me try this. And it sort of worked. That was my thinking. And the bonus was I got a good URL also, like publicpolicy.substack.com. It wasn't taken. So I thought, oh, why not? I'm sure people, when they search public policy, at least it might help in the SEO later. So that was another sort of a small motivation before picking that.
Yeah. Right now, Substack does not allow you to domain map your domain, and MailChimp allows it. Mm-hmm. I think the new kid on the block, Scroll Stack, may allow that as well. But that just I can understand. And there are two more questions which I want to like get slightly deeper with you. Is okay? You've decided everything. You have decided the format. You've picked up a platform. You've written your first newsletter. You probably sent it to 30 odd people and you have gotten some feedback. So there are two things. How did you incorporate the first feedback or the larger feedback which you got? What was the most useful feedback which you got from these users? And then how did you go about telling more people about your newsletter? Because obviously you can always write on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram, but then it's not that easy to just get those users, the right kind of users to start subscribing. So what did you do? The other two things, how did you incorporate the feedback and how did you spread the word around?
Yeah. Sort of one good feedback that I can recollect now is that when I started, I just had a boring name like public policy review for each of the editions. Right. So one, friend and colleague told me that, you know, don't have such boring titles and number them. So I now you will see there are each edition is numbered. So that gives the audience an indication that, you know, if 50 editions have been written, these guys must be writing a lot, right? So they can expect more. The second thing was use a nice quote for the article title. So we have some cheeky, mostly it is a very corny title from Bollywood or something that we put, but aim is that it should be funny and it should make people think, you know, it is, let me just click on it. So that was one good feedback I got. The other one was, yeah, generally feedback was don't write a lot, like it shouldn't run into 3,000, 4,000 words. And we've not kept that. Sometimes we break that rule ourselves. But generally, that was also a good feedback. Keep the article succinct, short. They should tell the main story as soon as possible. Because people hate scrolling. So the more that you have... that just reminds me, a scrolling point reminds me, the Substack look and feel on the phone is really good. The font size that it gives, even though the capability is quite limited, but the appearance on the phone is really good. And that was another thing that sort of pulled me in that let me start writing there.
Yeah. And how did you spread the word around?
Popularization was, just thought I'll share on Twitter itself because on Twitter, a lot of people who are related to public policy I'm connected to them. So I thought I'll share on that. So every edition, I just put screenshots of the stories and then I just put that week on week. So that's been the only channel that I have explored. I don't know. You might have better ideas on that front. So it's just been built through that.
No, you pretty much have nailed it because headings matter a lot. Even the subject line of your newsletter matters a lot. People tend to open after reading that. So I make a lot of effort when I write the heading. Like you make a lot of effort before those headlines and you want to write it cheeky or interesting or humorous. And they help actually. And reaching out to your core audience is more important than reaching out to everyone in the world. You know, if you already know your friend, ask the friend, or you ask your readers to share it with their friends. This is a better way of building your audience. And usually building an audience takes a while, like a year or two. So people should be patient. They will not, only few are lucky to have thousands of people. You're a publishing house. You have the luxury of reaching out to lakhs of people, but that's only for a few set of people. Last question. Is there a process which you have? Is there a routine which you follow? Like every day you devote an hour to write, to reading. You have already mentioned a bit about writing every day for some time, sending it on the same time. I send on Friday at 7:30 a.m. every day, every week. I don't budge from that. I mean, you also do the same thing. Is there a process or routine to you building the newsletter in terms of you read every day for 2 hours or something like that?
Actually, I don't have a routine because that's my job, in the sense that I'm reading public policy in and out. So, but what, like I said, that once you have that frame in mind, the theme in mind, you will start filtering all the news that happens, all the events that happen from that angle. So I just maintain a list of all my sections in my newsletter. And whenever I come across something which is, you know, which might fit into framework section, I just note it down in a checklist, you know. And then at the end of the week, my flow is to write whenever, let's say on a Saturday or a Sunday, then pick, go through that checklist, look at what has happened this week. Is there something that relates to what has happened this week? And then just start writing on that particular topic. So that's how I write. But Raghu follows a different method. He writes sort of more regularly on a daily basis, kind of a thing. So
if Raghu is not an imagination, if he exists, he writes like that. Okay, you also have to answer Arvind's question. He has an idea and he works in a financial company. He wants to write about India in the same set of topics which he thinks everyone else is writing. How should he go about writing that? Or start writing about newsletter, because he thinks everyone else is also kind of writing the same kind of stuff.
Yeah. That was a good question, Arvind. I would say don't worry about it, right? I mean, your take that you will bring in, your insight will be different from someone else. So there's no problem with that. The way he mentioned about the marketing point as well, right? Because what he's going to write for the organization might be similar to his views. So, the way I thought of it is that you can think of the India insights or your own product as your views. And in between, you can obviously reference some things that your organization is saying, or you can even put an ad that you want to put in towards the end. So that sort of works. But this is sort of your view, your point of view that you want to share with people. So yes. I don't think it's you need to worry about it. It's your view, you want to share it. Just get started and see the feedback. The advantage with your own newsletter as against the organization newsletter is obviously it is more freedom. You can explore any topic that you want in your newsletter. You can combine it the way you want. You can have very vague references if you want. So that those things are an advantage for you. So that's why I guess it's good to start with your own newsletter and then iterate based on the feedback.
All right. Arvind, do you have something else to say? Something you want to add?
Yeah, just a comment. Like, because I write on macro and investing, I tend to have charts. A lot of our explanation is either charts to charts. So Substack, you said Substack is not as conducive for charts, or if it has a piece has one or two charts.
All right. Arvind, we kind of lost you for a second. So I think Arvind was saying that because he writes on macros and he'll have a lot more data and charts and graphics to write, and maybe Substack is not conducive. So should you also explore something else? Do you want to add something to it?
It's good for putting some images in. So if you are going to create charts and visualizations of those figures, then that works. Not a problem on Substack as well. But if you have more complicated things, then that's not the platform. Even I observed it's a work in progress. So some things don't work in that. For example, currently embedding a Spotify link for podcast doesn't work, but embedding SoundCloud works. So there are still work in progress, but if you want to do a more complicated stuff, I think Ghost is another platform you might want to explore. That is work. And another one for slightly more academic thing is pubpub.org. And it basically allows you to again combine a lot of things just fashion it the way you want, and it's available free, open source, so you can explore that as well.
I just found Substack so easy to navigate and use. So it's just very, very simple to use.
So I would say that don't worry too much about let the problems arise when they arise. Okay. And then you can tackle them. Just start with the first newsletter which you want to publish it. Just do it. Nike has made it easy for us to do it. Just do it and then worry about the... So you have to develop your lens. Say demonetization happened. Pranay would say that it's a policy problem. I would say it's a public health problem because there would be less money in people's hands. Or I would say it's a small business problem. So depends upon the lens which you develop. Data charts and all, they're all secondary to your lens. I mean, whatever you want to convey, there is a way out on each of these platforms for you to figure it out. So don't worry about it. We are all here. You can always help. I mean, reach out to us. I will help you, or maybe other members from the community will help you.
Thank you. Thanks.
So I have Shavik. Pranay, we also have Shavik in the house, I guess. And I think if he's here, Shavik would raise... he would not agree with you that people don't like scrolling because he has already told me 100 times people love to scroll. Mm-hmm. Shavik, would you like to add something about scrolling and what should be the length of the newsletter? Should they like keep it to 200 words and not have a longish one? Do you have any input, Shavik? No, I don't think Shavik is here. So the thing is, researchers have found that people do not mind scrolling.
Okay.
People don't mind scrolling. And people, as long as they find your... So you have to kind of think and probably Substack solves that problem that it has to have that... yes, Shavik, please speak. Why is Shavik not speaking? Do I have to allow him? Shavik ji, please speak. You are allowed to. Yes, Shavik.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, Shavik. So Pranay was saying that people don't like to scroll.
I have not followed the entire thing that Pranay has said. So thanks for pulling me in on this. But my comment is more in the web space. And in the email space, there is very recently... As recent as yesterday, I think Jason Fried had put out on his Twitter account answering a small public question, what is good writing? Mm. And on that front, his response was a good writing is something where someone who's reading would not want to stop reading and would want to continue reading the next line and the next line and the next line.
Yes.
So if you can, I think, solve that problem, that it doesn't matter how long your article is. If you are not doing a good writing, I think if you look at it from that perspective, then it doesn't matter how short your article is. Even if people just skim through it, they'll probably not want to read through it and just skim through it and leave. On the web side of things, I still agree with this, but both the things have the same root point, which is as long as the audience's interest is grabbed and that is not getting broken. In that case, scrolling is a secondary thing. It's that you can't completely take it as an independent thing that, people will always scroll or people will never scroll. It is more of a part that is the content on that page or on the email interesting. But this one thing that you are quoting me on, Abhishek, I would still stick to it being in the web context. And I'm nowhere near an expert on newsletters. So I'll rely on Pranay's observation on this.
Okay, so answer to that question is we'll click on the link, we'll go to the web, and then you can answer that question. We are not reading in the client now, and that's more of a web thing. Thank you, Shavik. Thank you so much. Okay, we also have Joseph Jude in our amongst us. He's an attendee. I don't know if he'll be interested in, because he also sends a newsletter about inspirational, about work, about technology. I hope if he has a question, I would want him to join us and raise a question or two if he wants to. Joseph, are you there?
Yeah, Abhishek, I'm here. I didn't expect that you will shoot a question to me. It was a surprise. One of the things that I have observed is, I've been writing for 10 years. But only in the last 2 years or so, there's an interest in my blog. People are coming in and they are reading. What I see is, probably you are an institution that's a different, but for independent bloggers like me, distribution matters. So even in the newsletter space, like this year beginning, I wrote a blog post which Abhishek linked in his newsletter. Still, that is the topmost traffic blog in my blog, right? So I think the distribution matters. It is not only about writing. It's not only about the medium. We talked about both. I think the distribution also matters to bring in attention to your thing. So it is not like a question, but it's just my comment. Thanks, Abhishek.
Welcome, Joseph. Thanks a lot for sharing.
Can I just add to what Joseph mentioned?
Yes, please.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. Actually, one thing that helps is, again, it's like in podcasts, you have people referencing other podcasts and then they become popular, right? So given that now there's a critical mass of newsletters developing, it also helps if someone references your newsletter in that. So even we observe sometimes the traffic went up when it was mentioned in another newsletter and someone, you know, said, you know, why don't you go and check this out kind of a thing. So yeah, that is a good point.
Okay, Shavik raised the question about Ghost. How is Ghost related to newsletter? Do you know anyone who uses Ghost to send a newsletter or something? Because it's more of a CMS website publishing thing as far as I know about it.
No, I haven't. I was evaluating this before writing, picking up Substack. I don't know anyone who has written on Ghost, but it provides, one of the settings in it sort of provides you to write just newsletters and email integration, which is quite good in that. So it does what Substack does. It can do that plus some extra things. So you can use it to do an newsletter kind of function, is what I thought of.
So I think we have pretty much covered everything. I'll just recap very quickly. Like, most of what we have discussed falls under like four broad things: finding your audience, knowing about your audience, knowing why you want to write a newsletter, because do you have a domain expertise, or do you read a lot, you're passionate about it, and this is the larger thing, knowing your objective very clearly, why you want and what are the outcomes you want. Third thing is to developing your strategy, which is the kind of like you have developed, okay, these are the broad articles, broad frameworks I want to write, and these are broad content types I want to write. And then finally, picking up the right technology, which is the right platform, which you picked, Substack. So these are the four broad things which everyone has to like keep in mind when it comes to newsletter and the strategy and the content strategy behind it. And the more you read and the more the audience about. So these are the four broad things I'm just capping up and wrapping it up. I want to thank Pranay, you for joining us for the discussion, and the audience, Shavik, Joseph, Arvind, for asking questions. And to know more about this, you can go to the hasgeek.com/contentweb for updates, videos, and the next session, and hope to see more people and more audience in the next session where we will cover more interesting things about the newsletters. Thank you, Pranay. Thanks so much.
Thanks all. Thank you. It was great. Thank you.